A new course with a new story to tell and new materials to help you tell it. This video lays out the basic structure of big history. Let's start with a brief description of the 8 thresholds of increasing complexity used in the course, and then do a quick overview of the course materials. Let's start by looking at the course itself. If you haven't seen David Christian's TED Talk, or if it's been a while, check it out. Now, here's the short version. Big history is made up of 8 thresholds. Each represents a moment when the universe got more complex, so much so that there was no going back. The first of these thresholds is the Big Bang. All of the matter and energy in the universe came from this instant. About 400,000 years later, the first stars lit up. As the stars burned, new elements were formed, but it's actually in their fiery death that we find all of the elements that exist today. That's our third threshold. From this leftover stuff floating in space, new stars form. 1% of the material not sucked into the creation of new stars becomes planets, our fourth threshold. One planet in particular has just the right conditions, with just the right amount of energy and liquid water, for us to reach the fifth threshold, life. Zoom ahead a few billion years, and those first instances of life have evolved into humans. Collective learning, which humans are uniquely good at, represents the sixth threshold. We roam the Earth as foragers until the planet becomes so populated that we need to find a way to feed everyone. With the advent of agriculture 10,000 years ago, we cross our seventh threshold. Finally, around 250 years ago, humans learned to use energy in new ways during the Industrial Revolution, and voila, our eighth threshold, the modern revolution. We haven't been the same since. The Big History Project tells the story of these 8 thresholds over 10 units. So 8 thresholds, 10 units. If you look at the timeline on the homepage of the school website, or if you do the maths, you'll notice that not every threshold has its own unit. Here's how it breaks down. Unit 1 is an introduction to the course. It establishes the outline and explores the notion of origin stories. Unit 2 looks at the Big Bang. Unit 3 deals with the first stars and chemical elements, combining thresholds 2 and 3. Units 4, 5, 6, and 7 move through the next 4 thresholds neatly. Then in Unit 8, we talk about what David Christian calls the unification of the 4 world zones. Although this isn't a threshold, it's a critical part of the big history narrative. Unit 9 looks at the modern revolution, and Unit 10 ends the course with a look at the future. A couple of key points to make about the structure of these units. They are not to scale. What we mean by that is that the early units, which focus on pre-human history, are much shorter than the later units. If the typical school year is 8 months, many teachers try to get all the way to Unit 6 by the beginning of the 4th month. We'll talk a lot more about pacing in another video, but it's probably one of the most important aspects of planning your year of teaching the Big History Project. Let's talk about the content of the units themselves. If you go to the homepage of each unit, you'll find rows of lessons that are broken down into articles, videos, infographics, and activities. All of the materials are designed to be downloadable to make it easier for classrooms where not everyone has a device or where the internet connectivity is sketchy. But here's a tip. Even if you don't download any other materials, we do recommend that you download the videos before you show them to your class, just to minimize the risk of interruptions. Each unit also includes a unit guide that walks through the key ideas, vocab, and possible student misconceptions in that unit. A PowerPoint of the key graphics in the unit, a text reader that includes all versions of every article in the unit in Word document format. You're free to revise, edit, and reuse any of the materials in the Big History Project for educational use. These materials are there to make things easier for you. Each lesson is displayed as a series of thumbnails, which are just small images that make it easy to move from activity to activity. Something many people miss, so we're going to call it out here, is that the lessons are all available in long form. We call this the lesson view. The lesson view includes a ton more detail aimed at you, the teacher. This is where all of the details of the activities are displayed. While most students don't end up using this view very often, teachers tell us they find it helpful to use this view for planning purposes. In the lesson view, you'll find little hints on the left-hand side of the page that link to resources we think you'll find helpful. And on the right-hand side, you'll find random related facts and links to connected material. The lesson view is also one of the easier ways to get at the vocabulary for each lesson, Just look on the right-hand side at the top of the page. Back to the unit homepage for a second. If you look at the homepage for each unit, you'll see that after the last lesson, there's a row with the heading Other Materials. These are resources that you'll definitely want to consider using, but which aren't baked into the unit planning documents. Stuff included in this row, things like tests, quizzes, and older articles and videos. There just wasn't room in the lessons for our ever-expanding course. In this case anyway, other materials isn't a euphemism for I don't know where to put this. So let's recap. Big History tells the story of 8 thresholds of increasing complexity over the course of 10 units. In addition to all of the lesson stuff, the videos, readings, infographics, each unit includes a guide, lesson plans, and assessments. That's all for now, but be sure to check out the Big History Project Teacher Community on Yammer for more information about the course.